Hello students, welcome to SUFFA e-class. In the previous lecture, we have studied Newton's universal law of gravitation and also center of mass. So student, in this lecture, we will study uniform circular motion and magnitude of centripetal force. So student, let's see what is uniform circular motion. So student, we have studied the circular motion in the previous topic. In the previous lecture, we have studied the definition of circular motion. The motion of an object along the circumference or along the circle is called as circular motion. The motion of a body along the circle or the motion of an object along the circumference of the circle is nothing but a circular motion. So student, we know that this motion is possible when the object is acted upon by a force which is directed towards the center. That is called as centripetal force. We have also studied the definition of centripetal force here. Now student, what is uniform circular motion? So student, if the speed of a body performing the circular motion is constant, means if this body, this object is moving in a circle with constant speed, this motion is called as uniform circular motion. So we'll write the definition here. Motion of an object, motion of an object moving along the circle with constant speed is called uniform circular motion. Or it is also denoted as UCM. U for uniform, C for circular, M for motion. So student, this is the definition of uniform circular motion. The motion of an object moving along the circle with constant speed is called as uniform circular motion. You can also tell the motion of an object moving along the circumference of the circle with the constant speed is called as uniform circular motion. So student, in this way, this is the definition of uniform circular motion. Student, now we know the formula for gravitational force. F is equal to g m1 multiplied by m2 by r square. We have discussed in the earlier lectures, in the previous lectures, we have discussed the formula for gravitational force. So here one more formula is given in your book. F is equal to, if the distance between the two objects having mass m1 and m2 is r, then you have to use this formula, F is equal to g m1 multiplied by m2 by r square, or this may be d. It is given as d in your textbook. So the formula will be F is equal to g m1 multiplied by m2 by d square. You can also write this formula. So student, if we will consider this formula, this both the things are nothing but the distance between the two masses. So student, this force is inversely proportional to the square of distance between the two objects. In the Newton's universal law of gravitation, we have discussed that the gravitational force or the force is directly proportional to the product of masses and inversely proportional to the square of distance between the two objects having mass m1 and m2. So student, here the question is that why Newton assumed the inverse square dependence on the distance in his law of gravitation? So this is the question in front of us. So he was helped by the Kepler to formulate this theory of gravitation. He was helped by the Kepler's third law of planetary motion. Now we will see how Kepler's third law of planetary motion helped Newton to formulate his theory or to formulate that inverse square dependence law. So let's see. So now in order to see this, let us consider an object moving along the circle with constant speed. So this is a circular motion, this is a uniform circular motion. We know that for a circular motion, the circular motion is possible only when an object is acted upon by a force which is directed towards the center of the circle. We call that force as centripetal force, means the force acting on this object and it is directed towards the center of the circle, by which it can perform the circular motion, this force is called as centripetal force. So student, here consider the mass of the object is m and v is the speed of the object and the r is the radius of that circular path on which the object is performing the circular motion. So if m is the mass of object, v is its स्पीड, वी इज इट्स स्पीड एंड आर इज द रेडियस ऑफ सर्कल, देन सेंट्रिपिटल फोर्स, मैग्नीट्यूड ऑफ सेंट्रिपिटल फोर्स इज गिवन बाय, मैग्नीट्यूड ऑफ सेंट्रिपिटल फोर्स इज गिवन बाय F इज इक्वल टू एम वी स्क्वेयर अपॉन आर. सो दिस इज वन ऑफ द मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट इक्वेशन विच डिनोट्स द फार्मूला फॉर सेंट्रिपिटल फोर्स. सो स्टूडेंट, हियर वॉट वी हैव डन, वी हैव कंसिडर एन ऑब्जेक्ट ऑफ मास m मूविंग अलॉन्ग अ सर्क्यूलर ऑर्बिट और मूविंग अलॉन्ग अ सर्कल विथ कॉन्स्टेंट स्पीड v. And the radius of that circular path and the radius of that circle is R. Then the centripetal force is given by this F here is centripetal force. So this centripetal force is given by F is equal to mv square by R. Here m is the mass of the object which is performing the circular motion. And v is the speed of the object and R is the radius of that circle on which the object is performing the circular motion. So student, remember this formula. We will use this formula in deriving the equation how Newton was helped by the Kepler's third law. So now this equation is nothing but the, if a planet is revolving around the sun in a circular orbit in uniform circular motion, then the centripetal force acting on a planet which is directed towards the sun is given by F is equal to mv square by R. So student, if a planet is revolving around the sun in the circular orbit, then the center of that circular orbit will be sun, and the force acting on a planet is centripetal force which will be directed towards the sun, because sun is the center of that circular orbit on which the planet is revolving. So here the formula for centripetal force will be F is equal to mv square by R. Yes, so here we can consider m as, m is the mass of planet, v is its speed and r is the distance of planet from the sun. So student, here in the formula for centripetal force which is acting on the planet and directed towards the center of the circular orbit, that is directed towards the sun as sun is the center of that circular orbit. So F is equal to mv square by R. Here m is the mass of a planet, v is its speed and r is the distance of planet from the sun. So sun is the center and the distance from the sun to the planet is nothing but this r. So here you can see the formula for centripetal force. So student, the speed of a planet revolving around the sun can be expressed in terms of period of revolution. So here the period of revolution is nothing but the time required by a planet to complete one revolution. The time required by the planet to complete one revolution is nothing but period of revolution. So here period of revolution is T. The period of revolution, that is time taken by a planet to complete one revolution, is denoted by T here. Now we will express the speed of a planet that is revolving around the sun in terms of T, that is in terms of period of revolution. So let's see. So the student, the formula for the speed of a planet is given by V is equal to distance traveled upon time taken. So student, here we can consider the distance traveled by the planet in one revolution. So distance traveled by the planet in one revolution. So while doing one revolution, in one revolution the planet is traveling along the circumference of that circle. So the distance traveled by the planet in one revolution is nothing but perimeter of circular orbit, and the perimeter of circular orbit is nothing but 2 pi r. So here student, r is the distance of प्लैनेट, डिस्टेंस ऑफ प्लैनेट फ्रॉम सन. सो आर इज द डिस्टेंस ऑफ प्लैनेट फ्रॉम द सन. एंड नाउ द टाइम टेकन इज नथिंग बट पीरियड ऑफ रिवॉल्यूशन. सो टाइम टेकन इज इक्वल टू पीरियड ऑफ रिवॉल्यूशन दैट इज टी. पीरियड ऑफ रिवॉल्यूशन टी. सो स्टूडेंट हियर द वी इज इक्वल टू डिस्टेंस ट्रेवल अपॉन टाइम टेकन. सो वी हैव फाइंड वॉट इज द डिस्टेंस ट्रेवल्ड बाय द प्लैनेट इन वन रिवॉल्यूशन एंड दैट इज द पेरीमीटर ऑफ दैट सर्क्युलर ऑर्बिट 2πr. हेयर आर इज द डिस्टेंस ऑफ प्लैनेट एंड द सन. And now time taken is nothing but the period of revolution and that is T. So this is the formula. This is equation number 2. This is the formula for speed of an object, speed of a planet performing the circular motion. So student, we know that V is equal to 2πr upon T. Now the formula for centripetal force is F is equal to mv square by R. So here centripetal force is given by F is equal to mv square upon R. So student, this is nothing but the formula for centripetal force. So we have the value of V is equal to 2πr upon T. Now we will put the value of this V in the equation of this centripetal force. So this will become F is equal to m. Instead of V, we will write 2πr upon T. So it will be 2πr upon T. And here it is square, so I'll put here square upon R. Because here F is equal to mv square by R, m will be as it is. I will put 2πr upon T instead of V and I will give the square there because it is in square. And after that, I will write R in the denominator as it is. So student, let us solve this. So F is equal to, so m will be as it is multiplied by the square of 2 is 4, 4 pi square R square upon T square upon R. So now student, let's solve this. So here it will be F is equal to 4m pi square R square upon T square upon R. So here we can write this equation as F is equal to 4m pi square R square upon T square multiplied by 1 by R. This R will be multiplied and it will be 1 by R. So F is equal to, so this R will be cancelled with this R square and here it will be 4m pi square R upon T square. So now student, multiply and divide by R square. Multiply and divide by R square. So here it will be F is equal to 4m pi square R upon T square multiplied by R square upon R square. So student, this equation can also be written as F is equal to 4m pi square R multiplied by R square, it will be R cube, and upon T square R square. So we will take this R cube upon T square separately and we will write 4m pi square upon R square as it is. So F is equal to 4m pi square upon R square, 4m pi square upon R square multiplied by R cube by T square, multiplied by R cube by T square. So student, note this equation. Here we will consider this equation as the formula for centripetal force. F is equal to 4m pi square by R square multiplied by R cube by T square. Student, now Kepler's third law of planetary motion is given by, now according to Kepler's third law of planetary motion. So student, Kepler's third law of planetary motion is that the square of period of revolution of a planet around the sun is directly proportional to the cube of mean distance between the planet and the sun. So here it is T square by R cube is equal to K. So student, this equation can also be written as, by applying the invert endo, this equation can also be written as R cube upon T square. R cube upon T square is equal to 1 by K. I am applying invertendo here. Here it is 1 in the denominator, so I will apply invertendo, and this r cube t square upon r cube will become r cube upon t square, and k upon 1 will become 1 upon k. So student, now we can substitute 1 upon k instead of r cube upon t square in this equation. So this equation will become f is equal to 4m pi square upon r square multiplied by r cube upon t square. Instead of r cube upon t square, we are putting 1 by k. So here it will become f is equal to 4m pi square. Here 4m pi square is constant and k is constant. 1 by k is constant. So we can write 4m pi square multiplied by 1 by k, that is divided by k. Now it will become 1 by r square. So we know that here it is constant. Here 4m pi square upon k is constant. Hence this equation will become f is equal to k multiplied by 1 by r square. So we can write f is inversely proportional to r square. So from this we can conclude that this force is inversely proportional to the square of distance between the planet and the sun. So student, in this way Newton conclude that the centripetal force, that here F is nothing but the centripetal force, and that centripetal force, which is the force acting on a planet, which is responsible for the circular motion of the planet, must be inversely proportional to the square of distance between that planet and the sun. Newton identified, Newton concluded, or Newton treated this force as force of gravity, and hence postulated the inverse square law, or inverse square law of gravitation. Now in this way the student, if you will consider that gravitational force, so gravitational force is much weaker than the other forces in nature, but it is necessary to control the whole universe. Means all the planets are revolving around the sun, are following this law. So this is the nothing but the Newton's universal law of gravitation, and we have concluded that by using the Kepler's third law of planetary motion. So student, hope you understood this. Note all the points carefully in your notebook, and I have explained you all the steps in very detail so that all the concept would be clear in your mind. So study it well, derive this equation 2 to 3 times and study it well. So this is today's lecture. We will move towards the next topic in the next lecture. Thank you.